preaching about the abundant life and how Jesus came to give us that abundant life and what we got to do to get that abundant life. It doesn't just happen automatically. Amen. And so this morning I want to talk about decisions to get to that abundant life. So we're going to be in Joel chapter 3, verse 14. We're going to read a verse there. We're going to be in our anchor scripture, which is John 10:10. And we'll read those, and we'll jump right into this thing. Amen. So let's start. John 10:10 says, the thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. So Jesus said right there that he came for you to have life, but he also came for you to have it more abundantly. Somebody say abundantly. Abundantly. Amen. That's talking about you this morning. In Joel chapter 3, verse 14, it says, multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. Father, I thank you for your word this morning. Wonderful Master, I ask you to let your anointing fall in this place. I ask you today, Father, to anoint my lips to preach and teach your word. Anoint the ears to hear it and the hearts to receive it. I pray today, Father, that we would leave this place forever changed for Jesus Christ. I ask you today, Lord, that the way that we have been living life would pass away, oh God, but the new life would come, Father. The abundant life would happen today, God. I pray, Father, that you would remove the veil from our eyes, oh God, that the enemy has tried to put on us that says we cannot live this abundant life here on earth. Father, you came so we could do it. Now, Master, I ask you to put it in our hearts today. Open the eyes of our understanding. We'll forever know what you mean. Father, I thank you today for what you're about to do. I give you praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Can you give the Lord a hand clap of praise as you're being seated? Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. So for the last couple of weeks, we've been looking at the abundant life. And I wanted to just take a few minutes this morning and talk about the abundant life once again and how we're going to get there. Now, I know some of you say, Pastor, we done heard this for 6 or 7 weeks now. We got it. Well, some of you may have it, and praise God for it, but others of us ain't caught on to it yet. Amen. Look, when you come in here smiling at me on Sunday morning at first sight, then I know you're living the abundant life. Amen. Look, them at three people smiled in. You still ain't got it. Amen. But it's coming this morning. But as we read in Joel and we talk about decisions, the valley of decisions, about 2,800 years ago, give or take, the prophet Joel spoke of the people who are stuck in a valley and are unable to make decisions. Now, you'd think 2,800 years later that we would be able to make decisions. But it seems like we have the same problems that they have. Sometimes we get stuck in a place and we struggle. Today, we got to get past that struggle and step into the abundant life. The abundant life for what God has waiting for us. 800 years after the prophet Joel spoke these things about people struggling and the ability to make decisions, Jesus gives us a scripture, John 10:10, about the thief does not come but to steal, kill, and destroy. So we have this promise, though, from God that we could live what? The abundant life. Now, we spent weeks about this, and I'm telling you, it's important for us to understand this morning that every single day of our lives is a day that we get to make a decision. When you woke up this morning, you had a decision to make first thing what you was going to wear to church this morning. Amen. Some of you made a decision this morning if you was even going to come to church this morning. Some of you woke up and said, man, it's cold and it's wet outside, and I got to walk out to my car, my hair's going to get all messed up, and I just don't think it's worth going. That's what I said. But I remember I had a responsibility. But no, we have decisions to make every day of our life. But there are a few things that we must do. We must make a decision on what type of life we're going to live. That's the thing. What type of life are we going to live? It's a decision. It's a conscious choice. Every day, you and us must decide it. And I don't know about you, but I choose the abundant life today. I'm tired of living a way of a life that I get beat up by the enemy all the time. Hold on just a minute. It's just driving me crazy. Put it in my pocket. You know how I am about things. But so, I'm tired of always seeing God's people defeated in such a way when Jesus said that he came to give us the abundant life. So why are we walking around in such a way that we look defeated and we're God's children? Doesn't make any sense to me. And I know that sometimes things look really crazy in our life right now. A lot of things are happening. A lot of things are going on in life. But let me tell you something this morning. It doesn't matter how awful things are. God still sits on the throne. His promises are still true this morning. Amen. Nothing has changed with God Almighty. And even though it's getting close to Christmas time and everything may be going haywire in your life and things look bad, I'm telling you, you may woke up this morning and say, you know, I just feel like the closer I get to God, the worse things are getting. The closer I get to God, the next level I take with God, it seems like the enemy's knocking me down. And that's okay. But this is the time that the true believers and the true worshipers will stand up and say, I don't care about my situation or my circumstance. I'm still going to serve the Lord, and I'm going to live this abundant life that He promised me. He promised that to you. And beloved, we got to catch a hold of that this morning. It doesn't matter what everything looks like going around. You must choose the abundance. You must choose to be happy. You must choose to love other people. You must choose to love the people that you don't want to love. You must be able to show grace. You must be able to show mercy. You must be able to allow God to work in and through you each and every day. When you stop allowing God to work through you, the abundant life that you're choosing to live will never happen. If you'll start doing these things, we will see God turn the table, so to speak, in your life and have a blessing come upon you. You can live the abundant life. And I don't know about you, but I've been affected even myself by what God's given me. When I read and I get into this thing and I'm like, man, Lord, am I doing these things? Am I living this abundant life that you're talking about? It's caused me to look at things in a different light, so to speak. That maybe I need to be a little bit more forgiving sometimes than I am. Or maybe I know that I need to show grace and mercy in ways that I never really considered before. And think about it. If we start to show love, mercy, and grace just like Christ did, then in return, it will be shown back to us in the same manner. Remember the scripture I told you the other day, Luke 6:38. Give and it shall be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your bosom. For by the same measure that you meet or measure with, it will be given back to you. Now, that we always talk about money with that, but you got to understand, it's more than just financial giving. It's everything that I give, it will be given back to me in the same measure. It's always just not about money. And this is where so many people get hung up on certain scriptures, and they say, well, that scripture can only be for this. No, we have to get deeper into these things and see how God speaks to us in different ways. And I believe a person can make a decision to give in many ways. You can give by just a smile to someone. Just a simple smile. A simple hello. A handshake. A hug. Maybe just telling somebody you love them. Maybe just somebody this morning came in. Y'all knew nobody in the Hope Farms this morning. But as followers of Jesus Christ, you should love every one of them. Amen. And they should love every one of us. How many of you told them you loved them this morning? Don't raise your hands. Y'all have that opportunity after church. You give when you allow someone to make a mistake and you're patient with them. And you even help them correct it sometimes. And this is what I pray. God, give me patience in my life. I'm a person who does not have a lot of patience, all right? Unless I'm fishing, then I have a lot of patience. And I don't know why that is. But I need that kind of patience in my life. And I remember about a month ago, and maybe a couple months now, Caden came home from school one day, and he went straight to his room. And I could tell he was upset about something, and I was like, well, I wonder what's going on here. So I walk in there, and I'm like, what's up? And I can't tell you what he's doing because he'd be embarrassed, but he was just like, something happened today. And I said, well, what is it? And he said, I had a wreck. Now, normally, I probably would have thrown the chest drawer out the window or something, or something crazy like that, but I said, well, was anybody hurt? He said, no, nobody hurt. He said, just the truck. I'm like, well, let's go out there and look at it. And so we go outside, and where he backed into the wall, there was his bumper had got kind of, I think it was down. Yeah, it got bent down. And I looked at it for a minute, and I said, well, that ain't too bad. And he was looking at me kind of crazy eye because he's waiting for me to just go ballistic on him. And I said, well, maybe we can fix that. And so we got the jack out, and we got up under it, and we, so started jacking the thing up, bent the bumper back straight, and everything looked good, like it never happened. And I was very patient with him, and this just shows you how the Holy Ghost works. So about 3 weeks later, we was at church, and we went over to Captain D's to eat, and he was in the truck with me. And I went to back into a parking place, and bam. And he thought I was kidding with him because I always do stuff like that. And he said, real funny, Dad. I was like, I just really hit something. And he said, no, you didn't. I said, yeah, I think I did. I said, but maybe it was just my tire. And then he looked in the mirror and he said, no, you hit that block wall. And the guys beside me were going, so I looked at him, he says, good thing you didn't get mad at me 3 weeks ago, wouldn't it? See, whatever you sowing is what you're going to reap. Amen. See, if I'd have jumped all over him, I would have had no other choice but to jump all over myself that day. But I got out, and I was like, Lord, please don't let nothing be wrong with my truck. And I went around there, and thank God it was just a little scratch. But in my mindset, I was thinking, if I'd have went off on him 3 weeks ago, I probably would have just tore my whole truck out from just doing that little thing. See, when we sow these things, we start to reap the same things that we're sowing. That's why I say when you read that scripture, Luke 6:38, you got to understand these things. Give and it will be given to you. So the way that you give and treat people will be the way you are treated back. Maybe not by that individual, but it will be reaped down the road from someone. And what constitutes the abundant life for you is this right here. Are you someone who makes a lot of mistakes, but yet always gets on to somebody else and never looks at yourself? Are you willing to give these things? Do you back into things? Do you hit things with the car? Or do you sow in kindness all the time? Are you sowing mercy? Are you sowing forgiveness? Making a decision to live the abundant life doesn't mean that the abundance is just going to show up one day at your doorstep and knock you down when you open the door and say, bam, the abundant life just showed up. No, there's some things that we have to do in this. But it's going to happen as you plant the seeds. As you plant the seeds for the things you need in your life, then you can start to reap the harvest of the things you need. Remember this right here. I told you this the other day, and I feel it important to bring it back. You can never reap a harvest if you never plant seeds. And if you are reaping, you might be stealing. If you ain't planting that seed, but you reaping something, you stealing somebody else's blessing. Do you need more spiritual blessings in your life? Well, quit hanging around with a person who's so spiritual. You start planting your own spiritual seeds. Pray, read your Bible, worship like others worship, or worship just how you want to worship, but do something to plant seeds. Plant spiritual seeds, and when you do, the spiritual blessings will come your way. Sadly, though, the only thing that people do sometimes is just know who Jesus is. I know who Jesus is. Well, who is he? Explain to me. Well, he's Jesus. Well, who is Jesus? Well, he's Jesus. And that's good that people know that Jesus is Jesus. But there's more to Jesus. That's just the first step. When we have trouble in their life, people, all they want to do is say, I'm calling on Jesus to help me. But you've never had a relationship with him up to that point when all of a sudden you want the best relationship ever. Maybe we should plant some seeds right there. Maybe we should get into the good book and find out about who he really is and how our lives could serve him better. How could we better be a better witness for him and a better example to others? Maybe then you'll start opening up some doors to that abundant life. We start planting the good seeds. You never know what you might have just opened up the door to. The very thing you've been praying and asking God for that's been held up for so long, maybe God's just waiting on you to call somebody and ask them to forgive you. But maybe it's laying some things down at the altar that you had hidden in your life that you need to ask God to forgive you from. I know there's a person in my life that has always been doing, always been a giver. She has a generous heart. And I've had the opportunity to watch her make great, good decisions in her life. And it's affected me. And even though she was planting seeds in other lives and all, she didn't realize she's planting seeds in my life. And I remember a time that we needed money and we didn't have any money. And I remember up to before that, she had been sowing seed. And one day she called me and she said, She said, baby, she said, we got a check in the mail for exactly what we needed. A check we did not expect. And I'm not talking about a $10 check. I'm talking about $1,200 that we did not even foresee coming. And it wasn't that she sowed a seed that morning or that just that day when she went to the mailbox. She had been sowing seeds for months before, even at times that we couldn't sow seeds. She was still sowing seeds because she knew that one day a harvest might come out of that thing. And what she didn't realize is the biggest seed she was sowing was right here into my life. Look, you need to know that you got to sow seeds. You must sow seeds. It happened because she had planted. And now we were starting to reap. Does anybody in here need to start reaping some things? Does anybody in here need to start reaping some things? Maybe you've been sowing that mercy and grace and love, and maybe you need someone to forgive you. But guess what? Somebody, a person that forgives someone is only going to forgive someone that forgives others. See, if you're not a forgiving person, don't expect nobody to forgive you. Y'all didn't like that. Y'all must need to forgive some people. Lord, forgive all of them. The abundant life for some of us would simply be living in the realization that someone we've hurt very badly, maybe in our past, however long ago it's been, it's just calling them up and saying, hey, I need you to forgive. Removing pride out of our life. You know, I had to do that one time. I had to go to somebody and say, I need your forgiveness. I had went and I've told the story, I know, probably 100 times, but I had a guy working for me. He went and stole something because I made a comment. And he brought it to my house, and I kept that thing. And I had to go to that individual, and I said, man, I need you to forgive me for something. He didn't even know who I was. Hardest thing I ever did, to walk to somebody's house, knowing I could go to jail at that moment. And I said, something was stolen off your property, and I have it, and the Bible tells me that I need to return it sevenfold. I'll do whatever you need me to do. I don't have any money, but I'll come and I'll work for you. I'm going to return what was stolen from you. And he looked at me and said, son, he said, you've given your life to the Lord, haven't you? And I said, yes, sir, I have. And he said, you don't owe me nothing. And I brought that back to him, but I'm telling you, it sounds impossible to do some things like that. But if you're willing to do it, if you ever want God's grace and mercy extended to you, you better start extending it to others. And that man extended it to me, and so for me not to extend it to someone else is not right. Amen. So I don't know how you feel about it, but I choose the abundance. I choose not to be angry when I don't need to be, which I have to work on daily. I try not to be selfish. I don't want to be unforgiving. I don't want to be self-centered in my life. I choose to be happy. I choose to love, forgive, and I choose to be generous to others, and I choose to be kind. Why? Because it's a choice that I make. It's a decision that you have to make every day. You can decide whether you're going to be an ill pill or you're going to be a happy camper. It's your choice to make. I like to go camping, so I want to be a happy camper. And I'm not sure that we're supposed to live any other way in this life if we're a child of God. And I'm pretty sure we're supposed to be a bit more like Him than even ourselves would want us to be sometimes. 1 Corinthians 11:1 says, be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. Paul is trying to say, I'm trying to be like Jesus right now. Someone said, well, you know what, Pastor? I don't need to be like that. I can be my own self and still serve God. Well, let me just say this. How's that been working for you lately? How's that been working for you not being Christ-like? Jesus is our example, and we'll never truly understand what it is to live the abundant life until we begin to fully submit our lives over to Him, surrender it all, and say, Father, here I am. Use me how you want to use me. I give it all to you. Jesus told His disciples in Matthew 4:19, he said unto them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Look at something right here. To become fishers of men was to enter into a ministry. Oh, man, he's fixing talking about serving. Keep me tuned in. Following Jesus helped those men find their purpose in their life. Following Jesus helped them. The most confident and blessed and happy people are people who have discovered their purpose and their will in God's kingdom. Have you discovered yours? Have you discovered yours? Have you been asking God, what is my purpose? What is my mission in life? It's not just to be me. What is it? What is it? It's a choice. Those men could have said, no, I'm going to stay here and fish. This is what I know to do. This is all I've ever done. But instead, they made a decision, and immediately they set down their nets and followed after Jesus. Let me tell you what Jesus did at that moment. He gave them a blank check to do whatever they wanted to do as long as they did it with him. He gave them a blank check. What are you going to do with it when Jesus gives you a blank check? He's already given it to you. John 15, 7 says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask what you will and it shall be done. Oh, that's a blank check that Jesus has given us. The thing is, we got to be careful what we ask for sometimes. There was a couple. They'd been married about 40-something years. And they was having their 60th birthday together. And so the crowd of people was together, and they was getting ready to blow the candle out on the cake together. And they looked at each other, and they said, look, if we make the same wish, maybe it'll happen. And they said, well, what do you want to wish for? And he said, well, I say we wish for a genie. And if we wish for a genie, then if we get a genie, then that genie, we can make another wish. And so they both wished for the genie to come. They blew the candle out, and poof, there was a genie. And the genie said, you both get one wish. What do you want to do with it? And the woman said, well, I've always wanted to travel the world. And the genie said, okay. Snapped her fingers, and when she did, she had a ticket to every place in the world that she had ever wanted to go. And genie looked at the older man, 60-year-old guy. She said, what can I do for you? And he looked over at his wife. He said, baby, I'm sorry. He said, but I want a woman who's 30 years younger than me. She snapped her fingers, and automatically he was 90 years old. Amen. Jesus has given you that blank check. Just be careful what you do with that blank check. Amen. Has anybody ever got a blank check before? Look, over my life in construction, I've had people actually give me a check and say, go get material or whatever, and it would be just a blank check, and they were trusting me to go and write that check out for whatever it needed to be. But let me say this. If somebody gives it, if I give you a blank check, it ain't going to mean a whole lot because there may not be nothing in my account. Amen? Amen. But Elder Jim give you his checkbook, you might be able to go buy you an island somewhere. Amen? Y'all didn't know he was wealthy like that. You're going to have a lot of friends after service. But what I'm saying is sometimes we have a blank check, and God has given us that blank check. The thing of it is what are we going to do with it? Because I know that my Father, when he gave me a blank check, in 1 Corinthians 10:26 says, for the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He owns it all. Everything in the bank, he owns that too. Everything you got in your pocket, he owns that. There is nothing on the earth that does not belong to him. 15:7 of John, the New Living Translation, said, but if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want. Look, let me tell you something right here, and this is where you got to be careful. Maybe you've been asking for some things throughout this whole series. I want the abundant life. I want the unending life. This is the thing. Does John 15:7 operate in your life? Now, not the last part. We all like the last part of it. Ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. But does the first part? Oh, the first part. But in the King James, it says, the New Living Translation, they say, but if you remain in me and my words remain in you. You remaining in me. Let me tell you something. That pertains to your relationship with Jesus Christ. Remain means not just once a month. Not just once every 3 weeks. Remain means that, no, I have a relationship with the Father. I'm there when the, now I know we're going to have days we're in the church, but I'm there when the church doors open. I'm there for prayer meetings. I'm there for worship services. I'm there for all these things. Why? Because I want the abundant life, and I know that if I remain in him, then he's going to remain in me, and I'm going to have this abundant life. My words remaining in you. This is talking about the value that you're placing on God's word in your life. What value are you placing on it? Oh, well, I hear the word when I go to church on Sunday. Pastor breathes the scripture and I get the word in me. His word is not remaining in you. His word's not abiding there. You got to understand something. We've got to get into the word of God. You've got to understand what the word of God is speaking. You can't just rely on others to do it. We all love the idea of a blank check. But let me ask you this. How many of you would give God a blank check? Now, hold on a minute. I'm not just talking about your checking account. Everybody got mad again. You got to get past this money thing. A blank check of our calendar. Lord, use me whatever day you need to. a blank check of our talent. Oh, God, I can sing and I can play, but don't ask me to get up there. A blank check for these things. A blank check to love other people that you don't want to love. A blank check for other people that you need to give to that you don't want to give to. Or how about a blank check that says, use this part of me however you need to, Lord. How many would write that check? Because remember, when you give, it's given back to you. We love the idea of the blank check from God, but we don't like the idea of us giving him the blank check. God in his word makes us promises that some of us cannot comprehend. Promises that most people can't even believe. This is why faith is so important. This is why getting into the word is so important. All these things must happen. People cannot have faith without getting into the word. You must be into the word. This is why church is so important. This is why there's, as she was up here giving her testimony, that she's separated from her children, but she's in church and she knows God's going to work these things out. Why? It's faith that she has in God. She has a faith. She's found a new love, and it's in Jesus Christ. And she's willing to do whatever it takes because she has faith in it. Because he's a restoring God. Romans 10:17, what does it say? So then faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. If you're not in church and you're not listening to the word, then guess what? You're not hearing it. My words remain in you. Let me tell you something. All you want to do is come and have service and worship service, and then you want to get meet and greet everybody, and you don't like the preaching of the word, and you get bored through it, and that's what's happening. You're probably going to have a hard time receiving the things that God has prepared for your life, even though he already promised you a blank check. The check is sitting on his desk waiting for you to get it. And I'm not talking about money every time. I'm going to skip through some things, darling. So just stay with me on my scriptures. Ecclesiastes 2:26 says, God gives wisdom and knowledge and joy to those who please him. To those who please him. But also, it also says that but if a sinner becomes wealthy, wealthy how? Wisdom, knowledge, and joy. God takes the wealth away and gives to those that please him. How are we pleasing God? We're in his word. We're serving him. We're giving him our time, our talents, all these things. Hey, God, what about the ask whatever I will thing? Where is it at? We forget so quickly the part of that scripture that says we have to remain in him. Here's what I know right now. If I'm messing up spiritually, then I have no right to claim God's promises. If I'm not living like I need to live, I don't have no right to claim his promises. If I keep going down the same street week after week after week, I don't have no right to his promises. Am I lost and going to hell? I'm just saying that you need to get right with God. You need to quit visiting that same street week after week after week. See, God's word has so many promises attached to it. You name it, and I guarantee you can find it in this book where he gives you that promise. There's so much we can claim and receive through his word. But if you can't say with all confidence that you're living the abundant life, I just want you to know that you're missing out on some things in this word that he's already promised you that would help you get to the abundant life. Come on up, Mom, please. The story of Solomon in 1 Kings chapter 3, and I'm not going to read all this, but God appears to Solomon. And he gives him a dream, and he says, whatever you ask, I'm going to give it to you. Now, I'm paraphrasing all out of here now. And Solomon, we know, could have asked for anything, right? Could have asked for anything he wanted to. God was giving him that blank check and saying, hey, Solomon, just write it out, fill it out how you want to do it. And Solomon did say, he could have said, I want life, a longer life. I want all the riches. I want to be an idol in Jerusalem. I could ask for anything I want. But verse 9, he says this right. He says, So give thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, to discern between good and evil. For who is able to judge this great people of thine? Solomon asked for wisdom, understanding, and character. Not for himself, but for others. Not for himself, but for others. Think about that for a minute. Next time you pray, pray for someone else first. Because when you start putting others first, the abundant life starts happening. Look how God responded in verse 12 and 13. He said, behold, I have done according to your words. I have given you a wise and discerning heart. and I've also given you what you have not asked. How about that? God gave a little extra, didn't he? Both riches and honor, so that there will be not be any among the kings like you all of your days. You see how God done that? Start putting other things first besides yourself. The biggest thing is start putting the kingdom first. When you start doing these things, we see Matthew 6:33 come to life. Seek first the kingdom of God and all these things will be added unto you. Aim at the things of the world and guess what? There's nothing extra coming with it. But if you aim for the things of heaven, you might get a little world things thrown in there with it. You might get a little extra in there. Just be careful what you ask for. What are we going to do with the blank check that God has given us? How will you spend it? How will you use it? Will you use it for your own self? Or will you use it to help others? I hate to use these ladies as an example this morning, but I'm going to. They have an opportunity once they graduate from Hope Farms to pour into others and to share. So they have opportunity to sow seeds, and we have opportunity to sow seed in them. There's a cycle that happens, and we're part of that cycle. We always talk about a phrase about moving forward. I'm not going back. I'm going to move forward. Moving forward. I'm going to do this. I'm not going to do it like I used to. I'm going to keep moving forward. And every time we try to move forward, it seems like the enemy tries to knock us back. But what happens when moving forward happens in our life and we're living that abundant life? We begin to move out of that stuck place, that valley of decision that they were stuck in. We're able to move out of that, and we start to have a little bit of momentum going. I'm going to move forward with the Lord. I'm not going to stay where I was at. I choose the abundant life. And beloved, you have a choice this morning. You could choose to stay where you're at. You could choose to live a good life, just knowing the Lord on a so-so circumstance. Or you could choose to have the abundant life, where the blessings of God start to happen and you say, man, I don't even know where it's coming from. I don't even know where it's coming from. But you've been sowing so much and God is just letting you reap these things. And you're like, I just don't understand it. Just like when my wife opened that mailbox and pulled that piece of paper out and opened it up and thought it was another bill. And it was a check for $1,200. Man, I call that living the abundant life. Amen. Blessings just start coming your way and you don't even expect it. So what's your decision today? Are you going to stay in the valley? Are you going to stay in the valley and be selfish? It's hard. It's a hard word this morning, ain't it? But if we're going to get to that abundant life, this is what we've got to do. Stand with me for just a moment. I'll get you on out of here. This morning, if you came here and maybe you weren't expecting this type of message, I don't know what you was expecting. But beloved, as I told you the other night, I'm tired of seeing God's people beg for things. I'm tired of seeing God's people hurt. I'm tired of seeing it when I know what Jesus said that he came to do. He came to give us the abundant life. And that just wasn't for one person. That was for all of us. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you today. Lord, your word is just so full of promises and so full of understanding, wisdom, and knowledge. Lord, I pray that I have done your word justice. I've done you justice this morning by the way you gave it to me. I pray today, Lord, that if there's any in here that's in that decision-making process on what I should do, which way I should go, I hope today that they choose you. I hope today, Father, that they choose to follow you, to run after you. The enemy of this world will try to hold us back in every area of our life, Lord. But God, I know that in you and through you, all things are possible. Even when it seems like, Lord, there's no light at the end of the tunnel. God, you make a way. Spirit. I ask you to move through every heart, every person in this room right now. Speak to them as only you can speak to them. God, I pray that they would shake it out of my yard. Just feel in my spirit, and I don't know who I'm speaking to, but I just feel like the Holy Spirit says that you've been leaning on yourself, leaning on your own understanding for too long, and until you start to lean and trust on the Lord, you will stay in that valley of decision. You will not be able to move forward. You will not be able to go to the next step with the Lord until you quit leaning on yourself and start leaning and trusting on Him. This morning, if you're in this place and you need to make a decision for the Lord, I want you to step out and come to this altar. If you're here this morning, you say, Pastor, I need help. I'm in between mindsets, so to speak. I don't know which direction to go. I don't know what the Lord would have me do right now. I'm contemplating some things. But after hearing this word, I want that abundant life. If you need prayer for that this morning, I want you to come down. If you need prayer for anything, you just let me know and we'll make sure we pray for you. But I just feel in my spirit that the Lord said someone is just, they're not ready to release unto Him. They're trusting in their self. Father, I thank you today for your word. Father, if you would just lead us in a couple verses, whatever the Lord's put on your heart.